Welcome tonight. We coined Christmas at the Opera, and we began with the March of the Toreadors from Bizet's Carmen. And do you know what this march means? This is a march that is depicting bull fighting. And of course, we're not going to have anyone going to be injured tonight, but I think it sets a kind of festive mood for the rest of the evening. Now, what is opera? It's called Christmas at the Opera, but what is opera? Can I have a show of hands? Who has ever been to an opera performance before? And why don't I do this? Who has never been to an opera before? It's absolutely fine because my parents are here and it's going to be the first time they're going to sing this. They're going to hear singing in Italian and it's going to be absolutely foreign to them. But I think it's so exciting because we have now so many people who are a little bit interested in what we're going to do. Now, opera. What exactly is opera? 200 years ago, it was the YouTube of today, it was the cinemas of today. In the weekends, families, whole families would just go to the opera theater. In almost every town, every city in Europe, there's an opera house. And so the role of the opera house is to provide entertainment. And so what happens is something like this. It's actually, they call it the interlude before an act in the opera. What happens is that you have a break, and everyone is, during the break, everyone is eating. There's food, there are tables, sitting around in the hall, but somewhere outside, but they're eating and they're drinking, maybe a little bit of champagne, a little bit of red wine. And when they hear the orchestra play something like this, loud, they say, oh, it's time, let's quickly go back. And of course, if it's not so interesting in the opera house, everyone goes home. So it's so important. It's box office that we're talking about. It's the same with movies. If you go to a movie and you think it's not so good, you tell friends, and unfortunately that movie is not going to make so much money. And what are we going to do next? Do you know who's Puccini? Puccini is the name of an Italian composer. He's quite a famous composer. After today, when you leave the hall and someone asks you, oh, so how was Puccini? You just have to remember three things, and these are the things that will make you an expert, sound like an expert in Puccini, in opera, please. What are the three things? Number one, he was the Andrew Lloyd Webber of his day. He was so famous, and everyone knew his name, and they knew that if Puccini is going to have an opera performed, he wrote a new opera, that opera is probably not going to be so bad. It's not bad. We should listen to it. We should look at the critics and see what they say in the newspapers. Now, the second thing is that Puccini fulfills a lot of, what do we say, how do we say this? He is the stereotypical opera composer. Every stereotype you have about opera, about music, you know, a soprano singing high notes and then the glass shatters. It's almost similar to that because we have lots of, he writes so beautiful for the voice. We'll have Mimi and she would sing a really, really high note right at the end of La Bohème. And that is really, really going to be hard. And so he does that, he makes complete magic with melodies. Sometimes the melodies make my hair stand up a little. It's so touching. And the last thing about Puccini, I think this is the most important. If you remember this, you're set. Puccini was a really rich man. He made so much money from writing operas. And so this is completely opposite to you think about composers, classical music composers, and you think, okay, like Mozart, maybe his life was a little bit troublesome, he didn't have a very good life, he was always poor, but so he was absolutely not like that. He was just rich, he was a superstar. Well, so next, what we're going to do, La Bohème, we're going to do a scene from La Bohème. It's 20 minutes from Act 1. It's basically a very beginning of the opera where the two main leads meet each other. So I would like to now invite the two soloists for tonight to come on stage, please. What the kids' Philharmonic do is to have, you know, children perform with really professional musicians. Not because we want them to become professionals in the future, well, they could have this option, but the main aim is so that they're in contact with artists who are really, really committed to their craft. And of course, Ms. Jong and Mr. Tan here, they're both very, very professional singers, and they've dedicated their life to perfecting this art. So what happens in La Bohème in this 20 minutes? The girl, Mimi, she's a seamstress. You know, she does this, she makes clothes. And the man, his name is Rodolfo. Who is he? He is actually a university student. He studies poetry. And so he's not very rich. So it's Christmas Eve, and he's alone in his house. He's trying to do his homework. He's trying to do some poetry at home. And what happens? It's not so interesting. It's not such an interesting evening at the beginning, but he hears a knock on his door. And then he says, "Who's that?" And then he hears a female voice, and this will be sung. You'll hear that later. In Italian, but it's okay. And then the female voice would say, "No, excuse me." And then he says, "Ah, it's a lady." And then the music starts. This is their first meeting. Well, let's listen to some music, shall we? Did she just sing? What happened was that she climbed up the stairs, and then she was a little breathless. She says that, "Could I borrow," in the past, the original libretto was that, "Could I borrow a light for my candle which has run out?" This was in 1840, this was the original setting, more than 150 years ago. But now, we change it a little, and she says, "Hey, my iPhone just ran out of battery. Do you have a charger that I could use?" And so that's what she does. But then you hear in the music, da 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 da, and she sort of, "Oh, I'm a little fainty," and then he's a little bit concerned. So there's a lot of drama. And of course, if you know the text, it's good. If you don't know the text, it's okay. The music, a good composer has the music speaking for itself. Now listen to this in the clarinet. He played something just now, which is really, really good. Hear that? That is Lee's theme. That is her song. And what did Puccini start out with? You know what the instrument is? It's a clarinet. And you listen to the sound and you feel it's so serene, it's so calm, it's just a very, very peaceful sound. And that is what Puccini wants me to be. She's supposed to be, she should be a really simple person. She's a seamstress. She likes flowers. That's her life. That's how she is. He is very different. He is an artist, he is a poet, he's not so rich, but he's a poet and he has that kind of feeling. And you would hear this in the music. We'll go next. What happens in this is that we have 20 minutes of music. It's split into 4 5-minute sections. Puccini is really kind with this. It's so easy for us to listen to everything. First 5 minutes, they meet. This is what happens. The next 5 minutes, he will sing a song, and it's his song. This is the 5 minutes that he alone sings to say that, you know, "I am poor, but I am an artist." And you'll hear this in the music. Let's do this. So did you hear how broad that sound was? He says, in povertà. Povertà, Italian for poverty. In poverty, it's okay. Because my heart is made of my spirit. My spirit is a millionaire. I am a millionaire. And he sings that, oh, I can't do that. That's why I put that thing. But he sings, and you hear how broad he says. So he's basically saying his best points. He's showing off to the girl. He's saying, this is me. I'm an artist. And now we have her reply to him after he has finished what he does. So this is the third quarter, the next 5 minutes. So we have this star three. Hear what she said. Da 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 di la. Si mi chiama no mini. It means yes, my name is Mimi. Could you play this once more? What do you play at the very beginning? So Puccini foreshadowed this right at the beginning when she showed up and she says, "Excuse me, I would like to borrow a charger for my iPhone." And that melody is already there. And now she sings it. 5 minutes later, she sings that tune. Can we now go to star four. This is my favorite part of this excerpt because you know what she sings? La, 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 la. She sings that, you know, I'm such a simple girl, my name is Mimi, right? You heard that, it was so simple. Just strings accompany, she says, I'm just Mimi, I'm a seamstress. My life is simple, I'm not so interested. And then here, when we did this excerpt, she says, but when the snow melts and when the flower blooms, my life, you know, it's brighter. And this is so magical, because what happens if you look closely at what the second violins are doing? They're playing also almost the same melody as what she's doing. But they're doing it with a little bit shaking. In music, it's quite trembling. And what is this effect? Can you imagine when the wind in April in France, when it's a little bit, when it's 15 degrees, it's a nice, okay degree, it's not too cold, and then when the breeze starts to happen, and then you hear the sound, it's a kind of imagery. Could we do this once again? Can we do this excerpt once again? And I would like all of you to listen to this amazing picture that Puccini is putting together.
Thank you.
Could you imagine autumn leaves, something, some nature, some beautiful things at Bukit Timah Hill? I don't know. It reminds me so much of this. And the first time I heard this, I've never listened to opera before. I study music, yes, but I've never listened to opera. I've never been to a live performance until last year. I'm studying in Berlin. And because in Berlin we have three opera houses, so, and they're not so expensive, it's like maybe 10 euros for a concert. So I go there for the first time and I heard this music from La Bohème and I go like, wow, that's amazing. It's so touching and my hair stand up and I think this is what I wanted to do, to share that kind of joy and infection to our audience. We go on to our last quarter and this is the most important. We started out in the first 5 minutes where the two of them would meet. The next 5 minutes, he sings, he's singing his love song. And after that, he responds. And now we go on to the last one. And guess what happens? They sing together. It's really simple. It's a very simple kind of thing. What I want you to listen out for is that look at what they're singing. They're going to be singing at the same time, but they're going to be singing different words. And you could imagine if we are on the MRT or if we're in the market and I start talking and you start talking to me at the same time, it's going to be quite noisy. I'm not going to hear what you're saying and you're not going to hear what I'm saying. But in music, in opera, I think this is the main thing that impresses me. Because in opera, you can have people singing, you can have the singer singing at the same time, different words, but it's beautiful. For example, I just heard a performance. Do you know Barbara of Seville? Have you heard of this name? You haven't heard of this, it's okay. You heard of the music. That music, it came from an opera called Barbara of Seville. And at a point in the opera, six people sing together at once. Can you imagine? It's just music, it's just magical. And we're going to do this now, the last section. So what happens here? She says that, you know, let's be friends. And she says, no, you are an artist and we're in different worlds. And so this is the whole story behind La Bohème. It's a very common story. I think it touches me so much because it's not talking about aristocrats running around, princesses. No, it's different. We're talking about really commoners, a poor university student who wants to study poetry and a poor seamstress. And unexpectedly, because of a charger, because of something, they fall in love with each other. So I think that's enough talking, and we should listen to the whole thing. And what I would like you, if you could, is to think about these four sections and think about some experiences that you have when you're meeting your loved ones. It could be your kid, it could be your friend, it could be your partner. think about that. I think that relationship is so important, and I think that's why I'm so excited about this music. Well, so shall we start with this?
Thank you.
Can we have the singers out, please? Well, the next piece on the program is Phantom of the Opera. So I think a little bit more people would know this piece as compared to what we did in the first half. But it's called Phantom of the Opera, but it's not really an opera. At least that's what that's what Wikipedia says. It says it's a musical. I'm not exactly sure what the difference of a musical and an opera is. I think it has to do with a little bit of the language that's been used. Even though we have English operas as well, so I'm not sure. All I know is that it's a wonderful piece of music, and I remember it was in 2004. I was just in NS. It was at BMT, and it was December, and me and my bunch of friends, 13 of us from NS, we went to watch Phantom of the Opera. It was a movie in 2004, and it was a good movie. It reminds me of the things that I had to go through in the army. And I hope that it also reminds you of some kind of thing that you've done in 2004 Christmas.
Thank you.
And so I wonder if it was a coincidence that last year in December, around the same time, Christmas, we had Les Miserables, and I thought it was so interesting that we have these two operas or these two musicals 8 years apart. But the music sounds very, it sounds so connected to me, because it's melodies and it's things that we're familiar with. When I was young, maybe I would sing some Chinese song in the toilet and my mom would say, "Hey, what are you doing?" And it's strange, but it's okay. I think it's such a human thing to be singing. And one of the things in Les Miserables that has touched me to no end is the march that goes, "Do you hear the people sing?" We were just rehearsing this with the kids, and it's so difficult because it's a march. So when we think of a march, we think of something like, you know, something like this, and it should sound like, "Do you hear the people sing?" Something like this, but it's not, because in context, in musical context, there's something that goes, "Do you hear the people sing? Da 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 dee da." There's a kind of emotion that's in this music, and that connects to me so much on a personal level, and I hope you would share the same kind of attractiveness in this piece of music as I do. So, ladies and gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen. So I guess it's time for the Christmas component of our theme. We have the next piece, Winter Songs, and it's a very, very special piece because it's all Christmas music, and it's familiar to jingle bells. But what is the interesting thing is that it's composed, it's arranged by a very local composer, Pun Yu Tian. And he is the person that gave me all, he basically gave me the inspiration and encouragement to become a musician. I was studying with him privately. He was very kind. He knew how bad I was as a student. He said, "Don't give up." And that's what we're doing right now. So I think we don't have to talk too much more about Christmas. Let's let the music speak for itself.
Thank you.
When we started on this project, and when we started to think about opera and how the kids' orchestra could play opera, you know, I would say 99% musicians, professionals say it's impossible. Opera and kids, it's impossible. We can't do it. But we thought that, well, why don't we just give it a go? And I think that I have learned a lot just from this experience. I hope that the kids have got something to say after this, and I hope you had a wonderful experience this evening. Just before we go, if you have another 2 more minutes, we're going to play something for me.